Good morning, church, wherever you are this morning. We are so glad that you have chosen to gather together as we worship God today. We want to just welcome you and tell you that we are excited to be here this morning. We are excited that we get an opportunity to share good news with others. And right now, while we run through some announcements, if you want to take a minute and hit share on this video, that is a simple way for you to share the good news today. We're going to be worshiping together. We're going to hear from the Word of God. We're going to pray together and invite your friends on Facebook right now to be a part of that with us. We also want to let you know that we are excited and we are planning for a limited reopening later this month. We will have more information to come on exactly what that will look like and how we're making plans to keep you safe while you're here worshiping together with us in person. I also want to remind you that we have an opportunity to give back to God. Ministry is still happening. Ministry is still going strong, and that is possible through your gifts of your tithes and offerings. So if you want to mail a check to the church, if you'd like to access the link that I will post in just a few minutes to give online, we would love you to do that. But right now, we have those lyrics, and we are going to let Adam lead us in worship this morning.
All right, let's begin our worship this morning with Victory in Jesus.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning, then I repented of my sin and won the
Today we're reading from Psalm 100. Psalm 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, wouldn't trade it for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story of you. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I would know your heart, and I know they'll always tell who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scar. Now I'm standing in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I would know your heart, and I know they'll always tell who you are. So forever I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I can see how you delivered me. In your hands, in your feet, I found my victory. I'm thankful for your scars, 'cause without them I would know your heart, and with my life I'll tell who you are. So forever I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I would know your heart, and I know they'll always tell. So forever I am thankful for the scar. So forever I am thankful for the scar.
The scripture reading for the sermon passage today is from Romans chapter 5. So if you join me in Romans chapter 5, I'm going to be reading verses 1 through 11. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, although for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if, while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation.
Would you pray with me? Father God, we gather together in many, many different ways, God, but for the sole reason of worshiping you, Father, of pouring out our thanks for all that you are, for your perfect plans, God, for those scars of Jesus, God, that covered us before we even knew we needed saving. Oh, God, we thank you. God, today I am just especially mindful of all the mothers, God, the mamas, the obvious mamas chasing littles around this place when we're gathered together and probably tired at the end of the day, the mamas that have seniors that have just finished a different version of a senior year that any of us could have imagined. God, our moms that are still with us, and those moms that are already with you in their heavenly home, God, and we remember them and just ask that you fill us with good memories today of them. God, I also thank you for the women in my life and the lives of others that are like mamas, that have no blood relation but show up when we need them most, God, who might not even have children of their own but fill the needs that we have to be loved by someone unconditionally, God, and encouraged and built up. And God, we thank you. We thank you for your plans to put those moms, whatever that may look like, into our lives. God, today I just ask that you feel the praise offered up to you, God. That you feel our thanks, that you hear our worship. God, that you continue to be with us and remind us that we have no fear in you. That, Father, as we excitedly plan for a phased reopening here, even in our own church, God, that it honor you. That you help us make plans that keep our flock safe, God, and continue to restore those that are ill, continue to restore businesses as they open up, God, and just be with each and every one of us as we continue to be here and worship you today. Lord Jesus, we love you. It's in your holy name that we pray. Amen.
I see the work of your hand, galaxies spinning, a heavenly dance, oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your voice, all at once it's a gentle and thundering noise, oh God, all that you are, so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, captivated by your beauty. I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because mercy. I'm overwhelmed by you. I know the power of your cross. Forgiven and free, forever you'll be my God. All that you've done, so overwhelming. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. God, I run into your arms, unashamed because of mercy. I'm overwhelmed, I'm overwhelmed by you. You are beautiful, you are beautiful, oh God. There is no one more beautiful. You are beautiful, God, you are the most beautiful. You are wonderful, you are wonderful, oh God. There is no one more wonderful. You are wonderful, God, you are the most wonderful. Glorious, you are glorious, oh God. There is no one more glorious. You are glorious, God, you are the most glorious. I delight myself in you, in the glory of your presence. I'm
Happy Mother's Day. And just like our good God, whom we can run into his arms, and we know that he has mercy for us, and we can run into his arms, good and godly mothers we are thankful for. Happy Mother's Day. That we can run into our mother's arms knowing that there's going to be comfort, and that they show us mercy, and that they love us. So we do want to give a shout out to mothers today, and I may have a few more things to say about moms as we go through our study today in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. So this is an opportunity for you to open that passage so that you can follow along with me. There was a woman from Peoria who was on a tour bus excursion in Washington, D.C. They passed the Pentagon. And the guide said it took millions of tax dollars and about 1.5 years to build this Pentagon. And the woman from Peoria said, "In Peoria, we could have done it for less and done it much faster." The tour continued and they passed the Justice Department. And the guide said it took millions of tax dollars and almost 2 years to complete this building. And the woman from Peoria spoke up and said, "But in Peoria, we could have done it for less money and we could have done it faster." Well, the tour continued and they passed the Washington Monument and the guide remained silent. After they'd passed by, the woman shouted, "Hey! What's that tall white building we just passed?" And the guide looked and he paused. He said, "Search me, lady. It wasn't there yesterday." So it is with bragging. So it is with boasting. To a point, It can become irritating and put people off. There are lots of things to be thankful today regarding Mother's Day, and it's probably okay today to do a little bragging and boasting about our moms. How they cared for us, how they comforted us, whether it was a little physical wound or an emotional wound. When we felt disappointed, or we didn't get our turn at something, or our brother or our sister didn't quite share the way we thought they should share, our moms would comfort us, make things better, make things right, and so we're thankful for moms. Oh, I might brag that my mom can fix 100 hot meals in 3 hours. No, wait. That's the grandma's catering ad. Think about what you might brag about for your mom today. To be boasting in her goodness and godliness and in the way she cares for you. But remember what mom always said. Don't brag, it's unbecoming. Tell the truth and don't toot your own horn. Indeed, that's good wisdom from mom. Generally, boasting in the Bible is discouraged. Proverbs 27, do not boast about tomorrow, for you do not know what a day may bring forth. Even just last week in Romans 4, we read and studied and reviewed how Abraham, as good as he was, had no reason to boast before God. And in that same passage in Romans 4 last week, we had a quote from Psalm 32, and it's David, King David. And even though he had been triumphant and victorious, and he'd also had some sin in his life, and he recognized that he didn't have any righteous standing before God and had no reason to boast. And so as we were in Romans 4 last week, and we were reviewing that Romans 1 through chapter 4 was really about Paul telling us over and over and over again that we are justified, have right standing before God through faith alone, in the grace of God alone. That it was declared, Abraham was declared righteous because of his faith in God, because of his belief that God would do what he said he would do. And then it was declared that Abraham was righteous. So boasting is something we're generally to be on guard about, aware of, avoid. The Roman citizens at the time that this passage was written in this book of Romans, this letter to the Romans by the Apostle Paul, had a saying, not quite sure I've got the Latin right, but civis Romanus sum. I am a Roman citizen. And that would be what they would boast about. And to declare that I am a Roman citizen was virtually to guarantee my safe passage anywhere within the Roman Empire, that the strength and the mighty arm of Rome would protect me, a singular citizen, if I were to proclaim, I am a Roman citizen. Well, we pick up a passage today that is going to address boasting. Kind of thing that we would have to boast about, the sort of thing that we should boast about, something that we can't contain ourselves, boast about it. It is about the peace we have by being justified by Jesus Christ. It is about the hope we have of the good news gospel of Jesus Christ and being saved and secure. In Romans chapter 5, we have here our theme today is come together with good news. The whole book of Romans is about coming together, people from all races coming together under the good news gospel, the hope that we have in that gospel, the peace that we have through that gospel. And so the title today is Peace and Hope. It starts off with Paul going over this whole idea of faith alone. By the grace of God alone, we are justified. Again, he spent four chapters already going over that. Why the repetition? Why the reinforcement, the emphasis, the pounding of faith alone, by the grace of God alone? It could be that, like a lot of things, it's in my head, but I haven't really got it in my heart. And I don't really completely understand what it means to have this justification, to be covered in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So, in important things, like a good professor, he is reinforcing for the students, for the hearers, for the readers, for you and for me, he is reinforcing, oh, this is such a good thing. This grace that we have by having faith in Jesus Christ. To get it from our head to our heart as best we possibly can, this side of glory in heaven. Let's read some of the verses here. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Wow. Therefore is referring back to Romans chapters 1 through 4. Therefore, because you have been justified. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace. You know, before we're right with God, we are enemies of God. We may not feel that we're at war with God, but he's at war with us if we're not righteous, if we're unrepentant, living in sin, haven't received justification through Jesus Christ. So this peace with God means that that division, that separation from a righteous, divinely righteous God is over. It's peace. It's safe passage. I have peace with God. It is a vertical peace, my peace. As a created child of God, at peace with the created God, creator God. I have peace with God. Later in this passage, it speaks to the wrath of God, of being separated from him and being in his wrath. If I'm at peace with God, the wrath is removed. I have clearance. He has covered me with his righteousness through Jesus Christ. I have peace with God. My peace with God then horizontally allows me a means of being right with others. Love God and love others. A horizontal peace. Being at peace within my family. Being at peace with mom. Being at peace with my coworkers, being at peace with my neighbors, being at peace. Oh, it's a divisive time. There's all kinds of opinions and views and politics. Can we be in peace with one another? Well, it starts with this vertical peace with God. And with this vertical peace with God, we have the means to be at peace with one another. This peace is described here isn't just a feeling, it is a fact. In fact, we can have the certain peace that is described here without having the feeling of peace. because I am justified, covered by the righteousness of Christ, it is a fact that I have peace with God, whether I feel it or not. It's not dependent on my feelings, my internalized feelings. It is a fact. I have peace with God. I have peace with God. I am free from his wrath. I am covered by his righteousness. I'm consumed with his love. I have received his grace. I have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace. This peace come together with good news, peace, and hope. This peace that I have gained access by faith in this grace. Again, faith alone. In the grace being unmerited favor, something I do not deserve, a gift that has been given freely to me, the righteous covering of Jesus Christ. We have access to God. In Ephesians 2:18, it speaks of the same access being direct access to God. Here in Romans 5, it is access to the grace of God, that covering, that gift, that unmerited favor. We have access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. We stand in his righteousness. We have standing in his kingdom. We have standing in the family of faith. Regardless of race, it's about grace. Coming together under grace. Regardless of my position, my post in the world, my resources in the world, my talents and abilities in the world, I have standing in the kingdom of God. I have standing with God. He stands with me. He calls me his son. I have received his adoption. I am now standing as a child of God in the kingdom of God through the grace of God. And we boast, in the hope of the glory of God. The glory of God. Oh, the glory of God. I can imagine, but I can't comprehend. I can think about what it might be like, the glory of God, but I won't really know until I am in his presence in the heavenly realm. But I have this hope isn't a wishful thinking hope. This isn't I've crossed my fingers hope. This is a certain hope. It is a sure promise of God that we will be in his glory, that we will be heirs of the kingdom. We will inherit a place in his spiritual house that he has provided for us. Then in verse 3, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame. So, right now, I'm not in heaven's glory, but I have a certain hope, a sure thing of being in God's glory, that it is secure for me, that he has prepared it for me, that he has provided it for me, because I am covered in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. But now, while I am still a man on earth, I will have trials, I will have tribulations, I will have suffering. What hope is there in suffering? Well, there is this hope that I have access to the grace of God always. That access to the grace of God and to God the Father is always sure and certain. No matter where I find myself in life situations today, in dark and desperate situations, in despair, I have access to God. I have that hope. I have a promise that if I turn my struggles, my sufferings, my trials, my tribulations over to God, He can use them for my betterment. He can use them for His glorification. He can use them to prove me as a fine, precious metal such as gold is purified by fire. So some versions of the scripture will say regarding character, proven character, as if you have been proofed, or a proofing, that our circumstances that are difficult, that we really would call suffering, oh, that we would be reminded that if I turn them over to God, we have the promises of Romans 8, 28 and 29, that He will work all things together to good for those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. I have this hope while I journey still here on earth. I have this hope to persevere, to prove my character and give testimony and witness that my God, even in my suffering, is still with me and I have access to Him. And He's going to work this together for good. We might consider the story of Joseph. Oh, Joseph, who was given by Israel, Jacob, the coat of many colors. And his brothers were jealous of the special relationship that Joseph had with Dad and the coat. And so they trapped him and trafficked him into slavery. And he ended up in the ministry of the Pharaoh. And in Genesis 50:20, he says to his brothers, he's forgiven them, but he says to them, what you meant for evil, God meant for good, and to save many. So consider that in this present world, in this present time, I have the hope of glory in the future. But I also have the hope of getting through my struggles, my sufferings today. Perseverance produces character, character, hope. And a hope that does not put us to shame. A hope that does not disappoint. Ah, He blesses. He's a good God. A God who keeps His promises. He will not disappoint. I do not need to be ashamed of this gospel. In fact, in Romans 1:16, as we started this series a few weeks ago, Paul proclaimed, I am not ashamed of the good news. This is part of the good news, that I have this hope that comes from having peace with God, that comes from having the grace of God, which covers me in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So I have this hope, and I shouldn't be ashamed. I should boast about it. Tell others of the goodness of God. Oh, I'm reminded of 1 Peter 3:15, to always be prepared to give an answer for the hope that you have. I have hope for today. I have hope for today, even in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic, in the midst of unemployment, in the midst of separation, in the midst of uncertainty about what's going to happen, what's the sequence of things going to be with recovering and coming out of the COVID-19 pandemic. Well, even before COVID-19, I had things that would cause me to be unsure about the way of the world, my safety and security in the world. Even before COVID-19, there was disparity, there was distress, there was despair in our world. I have a reason to hope in all of those circumstances that God will work it together for good. I can boast about it. I can proclaim the glory of God. I can proclaim the hope that I have within me. I can share the good news with others. Well, in fact, right now, you can do a simple act of just sharing this worship service on Facebook. A great way to say, I am not ashamed. I have hope. Here is the reason I have hope. It is a hope for today and for the future. Boast about it. We have reason to boast about our good, loving, giving God. Boast about it. Oh, how loving is he? Let us look at Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still God's enemies, Christ died for us. While we were still wandering aimlessly, without worth, without purpose, God died for us. While we were wandering as wasted potential, wasted people, just wasted because we hadn't come into the righteousness of God, he died for us. He demonstrates his own love for us. That he desires to put us in a right relationship with him. He desires to give us the best purpose and plan for life now and forever in heaven's glory. He desires for us to be his sons and daughters. He desires to us to have standing in the family of faith. He desires to give us an inheritance that we can't really comprehend. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? When I'm going through the sufferings of today, I'm reminded that this is not all there is. That God is going to use it to work good. That I am reminded that whatever suffering I might be going through today is no comparison to the suffering I would have if I were to be in God's wrath. It gives perspective to suffering today. God saved me. There is glory to come. Verse 10. For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only this is so, but we also boast in God. Boast about it. Boast about it. Boast about it. Proclaim his name. Declare the hope that you have. Give an answer for the hope that you have. Boast about it. Boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have received this reconciliation. What's described in Romans 5, 6 through 11 is an unrivaled love of Christ and God the Father. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have life everlasting. Unrivaled love. We get glimpses of unrivaled love from our godly and good mothers, and thanks for those mothers. We have reason to boast. We have been justified by faith alone, through God's grace alone, to the family of faith, to have a right standing, complete access, an inheritance from the Father, we have reason to boast about it. Spurgeon put it this way: you will never exaggerate when you speak good things of God. It is not possible to do so. Try, dear brethren, and boast in the Lord. Boast about it. Boast about it. The hope that you have, the peace that you have, if you are a son or daughter of the Most High God. Let's pray. Oh, Lord God Almighty, thank you for adopting me. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for an unrivaled, unconditional love that took this worthless, wasted person destined for wrath. And you gave your son as an act of love. And Jesus, you gave your life and shed your blood as an act of love to cover me in righteousness, to mind the gap, to cover the gap, to cover my separation from God, to give me a peace that is a certain peace that makes me at peace with God Almighty, that allows me to have the means to be at peace with mankind, that allows me to have a peace that I can get from my head to my heart, that allows me to know for certain, oh God, that I am a child of yours, and you have your arms open, and you draw me in, and you hold me close, and you comfort me when I'm going through difficult times now, and you promise me an inheritance and a glory. Oh, thank you, God. Lord, this is the prayer that I have in my heart today, that everyone will know this peace and hope that comes from faith alone, through your grace alone. Oh God, may we respond to you. May we call on your name. May we boast about it. Amen. We're going to have a closing song today. It is a response song. It is an opportunity for you to respond to God stirring in you, His Holy Spirit wooing you, His arms being open for you. He's a God of peace in an unsettled world. He is a God of peace for all eternity. He is a God of certain hope. I pray that you know this hope, that you know Jesus Christ, that He's your Lord and Savior, that you've said, Lord, it's not about what I can do. I can't do it. I need you. So as this song is played today, consider your walk with God, how you might respond to God, how you might boast about it. And may God be with you until we come back next week.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul, though saved.
Well, here